If you want to establish linear independence in some general vector space, you can use coordinate vectors. And if you want to know whether a vector is a linear combination of other vectors in some general vector space, you can use coordinate vectors as well. And it's nice, of course, because that means that we can apply all the techniques we learned already for vectors in Rn, like row reduction, etc. But why can we use coordinate vectors? Well, that's what you will learn in this video. Because we have two important properties of coordinate vectors. If we have two vectors u and v, the coordinate vector of the sum u plus v, so u plus v in the basis b, will be u in the basis b plus v in the basis b. So you can either add u and v first and then compute the coordinate vector, or compute both coordinate vectors and add those. We have to show that, of course. And you can take scalars out. So if you have c times u times the coordinate vector of that, you can take the c out and compute the coordinate vector of u first and multiply that by c. Let us take some basis b, consisting of the vectors b1 up till bn. So we can express both u and v in our basis b. So we know u equals c1 b1 up till cn bn. Our v will be in general some other vector, so u v equals d1 b1 up till dn bn. And then we can write down the coordinate vectors immediately. The coordinate vector of u with respect to b is just the weights, which are c1 up till cn. So there we go. And the coordinate vector of v, just the weights of v in the basis b, which are the numbers d1 up till dn. So what happens now if we compute u plus v and then the coordinate vector? So we add u plus v. So we have a c1 b1 plus d1 b1 over here, and then c2 b2 plus d2 b2 as the next term, etc., until the last term, cn bn plus dn bn over there. There we go. So it's the coordinate vector of the sum. Well, just the weight in front of the b1, b2, etc. But the weight in front of the b1 is just c1 plus d1. And then we go on until the last weight in front of the bn, which is cn plus dn over here. And then we see that the coordinate vector u plus v in the basis b is just a sum of u in the basis b and v in the basis b. So that property is checked. So what about a scalar times u? Well, if we compute the scalar c times our vector u, so we multiply our u with c, we get this vector over here. What's the coordinate vector of c times u? Well, the weights in front of b1, etc. So the first weight equals c times c1, that's over here. Second weight c times c2, etc. until the last weight, c times cn, over there. And we see that the coordinate vector of c times u is exactly c times the coordinate vector here of u. So then we have established both properties over there. Well, why is that so useful for us? Well, look at this equation over here for the consequence. Suppose we look at the equation c1 u1 up till cn un equals 0 over there. And we wonder whether that equation has a non-trivial solution or not. Well, you know, if this equation has a non-trivial solution, then the vectors u1 up to un are dependent, and otherwise they are independent. Well, the u1 up to un are in some nasty vector space in principle. What happens now if we take the coordinate vectors? Well, if we take it on the left, then we also have to do it on the right. Coordinate vector of 0 is just a 0 vector, of course. And due to those two properties over here, we can split up this large vector in coordinate vector of c times u1 plus c2 times u2, etc. And then we can take the scalars out to get this equation over here. But that is exactly the condition for whether the coordinate vectors are independent or not. So what you see is that these two are actually equivalent. So if you want to know whether general vectors are independent, you can look at the coordinate vectors, whether those are independent or not, and you know how to do that. And same holds for independence, etc. So that is why coordinate vectors are so nice, because they allow you to use the techniques you know to check independence and that kind of stuff.